on a pursuit of other. Rather, it's simply that in order to live my life, what I feel guided to, how my life moves, and how my life has been orchestrated, is a balance of both. And I feel that that's a healthy way. And it's not a way that I've chosen with my mind, but rather it's a way that naturally over the years I've been led to create. So there's times when I'll be in quietude too much and I'll feel the motivation within myself to be more interactive in society. And then there'll be times when I'm very interactive in society where I'll feel within myself the need to retire into periods of quiet. So ultimately, I find that my system likes to balance itself. And there may be times in the future where I spend extensive time in society. There may be times when I spend extensive times alone. But it's not my mind upholding any philosophy, any strict concept that says you must isolate for this amount of time or you must be involved in society because it's your duty. I find that when I just stay surrendered in the moment, life moves me into interaction and life moves me into solitude. And the energy of the higher self, this universal intelligence, just puts me where I need to be. So that's an aspect of trusting. Now, in order to get to that state, a person needs to be very clear about their own motives and their own motivation. For it's very easy for the psyche to subtly manipulate this process. And choose to have their own projections override what they feel they should be doing from their own intuition. So some people will rationalize the experience of social avoidance and say, this is what God wants me to do. This is what I know I should do. And yet it's up to that person to feel inside themselves if they're doing what's appropriate. I can't tell you and I can't tell any other person what they should be doing. That's not my role. My role is to help you find that connection to your higher self within so that you can live the role of serving the divine, of serving your higher self. So it's my role to just help you try to understand it rather than telling you how to perform it.
Yeah, you know, that's exactly what I'm feeling from within. It's so subtle, like, you're right. Before it was the ego wanting to study and wanting to be a certain way, become a certain, way. And now it's more of like naturally happening where certain times, you just want to sit in quietude and there's nothing wrong with it. There's no judgment. And certain times you just want to go out and see the world and see, people, mm-hmm. talk with people. Definitely like a natural thing also happening
within me. Yeah, because we are social creatures. This planet has a lot of opposites in its dynamic. We have light and we have a night and day. We have periods of being awake, periods of being restful, periods of activity and inactivity. We have the cycles of the season. And so the natural balance of the human being is to engage with people and be solitude, to engage with the family and to be involved in the greater society. We see that in common life, that whenever we go into imbalance in any of those things, we create suffering. So this is where we have to be very clear about ourselves. So if a person, based upon their past experience, their past trauma, displays like addictive behavior patterns as a response to their environment growing up, they can choose to avoid themselves, avoid their inner silence, avoid the purification that happens in meditation by always being active in pursuits of things in the world. And then the opposite is that a person can avoid the healing and purification that happens in our social involvement by choosing to be isolative. And so we find this very commonly in people, almost every person, because most of us have grown up in some degree of trauma in our environment, in our household when we were children, and even in a society in which trauma is regular. Anger is commonplace. Emotional and verbal abuse is commonplace. physical abuse was more commonplace than it is now. It was more an accepted part of society a few hundred years ago. But emotional and verbal abuse is still very commonly accepted. We turn on the television and we see this. We see anger, we see rage, we see yelling, we see, you know, all kinds of emotional dysfunction. It's still accepted as normal. Whereas physical violence, like domestic physical violence, we don't see so much on the television. Or when we do see it, there is always the clear knowing that it is a wrong behavior. You know, usually a person will be punished when they display physical domestic violence. But domestic abuse with emotions and words and mind, like twisted psychological manipulation, that's not being punished. Society says, oh, that's normal, that's how it is. But see, gradually society's moving, and soon we'll recognize in a global setting that verbal and emotional violence is not appropriate. It's not a healthy behavior, and it doesn't help improve society. And so we have to be on guard, we have to be aware of ourselves to see if we're displaying any social avoidance behaviors in order to, the reason why the ego does these behaviors is part of a self-preservation. So it's not that we're doing it for wrong reasons, it's rather that because of our conditioning as we grew up, we learned how to cope with our environment by creating these behaviors. So if we lived in a threatening society, if we were always beat up by bullies in our neighborhood, then we would choose to stay home. We would choose to control our external environment very, very tightly so that we would avoid getting beat up. That's common. That's a self-preservation mechanism. It's not bad or wrong. But as an adult, as we move out of the environment, and in the adult world, people typically don't beat up other people. There aren't physically abusive bullies in the world as much as there are in the children's world. So when we grow up, we realize that the world is a safer place. We can walk on the street and not get beat up, unlike as we could when we were a child. But the problem is that as adults, we usually don't clear our personal past. We usually don't heal that wound that was felt as a child, where it wasn't safe to be in the neighborhood.
I have a question to ask you here.
Yes.
When I'm in the awareness state, I could be almost around anyone, and I don't feel like an aversion or anything like that. I totally feel at peace and calm, and I know that there's a reason why I'm here, you know, with this person. So that's definitely a wonderful thing. But as soon as I go into, as soon as this ego acts out and it's really strong, then I totally see the aversion. I totally see the, even energetically, like my heart starts beating when I think of that person or, you know, someone who has hurt me and who continues to do that. It's really like, it's here, you know, both are here. Mm-hmm. Both the awareness and the ego are here. Mm-hmm. So I'm really fortunate to, you know, again, have that choice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so one thing that you can do when you see your ego responding based upon its old habits and patterns, you break that pattern, not by judging as being right or wrong, good or bad. You don't put an emotional judgment on it. You don't belittle yourself. You don't attack yourself through judgment, through emotional based judgments. Instead, you see the choice and you realize this is the behavior of my ego, and this no longer serves me. And so you're not judging it emotionally with, you know, yuckiness, with bad or wrong, right or good, holy or unholy. Instead, you're realizing it's not what you want to create. Okay, so we don't get emotionally involved in our judgment, and that way we're staying as the awareness still. We're making a choice in consciousness rather than being enmeshed in our emotions.
Okay, I understand.
Okay, so in that space of clarity, you understand that this is no longer what you want to be creating, and you know why this pattern exists within you. You understand it was formed and shaped by your environment when you grew up, or maybe the environment that you're in now because certain people are present, but it's something that you no longer wish to create. And then by coming back to this moment in the state of peace and love, and feeling the energy of divine love within, you immediately That energy immediately disempowers the reaction. So what you'll notice, maybe inside your emotional body, is that when you have this emotional subconscious reaction, different organs or different areas of your body may have an energy to it, such as anger. When people feel anger, often their liver exudes a heat. From the area of that part of their body, there's a heat. And the third...
I only feel the heat when I feel the anger.
Mm-hmm, yeah, and then the third chakra, which is associated with that region of the body where the liver is at, that third chakra is our fire energy. Okay, that's the elemental energy. And it's also related to how people see us. Fire is like light. So we get our self-image from how other people see us. We feel good about ourselves when other people give us approval, when they see us how we want them to see us. Most people's egos are always telling other people who they are. We're saying, I'm this person, and the person, and we become happy when other people agree and say, yes, you are that person. And so that's all third chakra. Okay, that's the limited personal self. The higher self exists more fully in the higher chakras. Well, when all the chakras are purified, that's the full embodiment of it. Because the third chakra does have higher ideals rather than just this ego self-centeredness. So when we're angry, the external world is not behaving as we say it should. Okay, that's the third chakra, that's fire. The world's not seeing us how we want it to see us. And so we have the anger, we have the heat, the liver's involved with it. So often the stomach is involved, but the stomach, it's in the same area of the body. The stomach has a different function as well than the liver. The stomach will also respond, its inability to control, to get what it wants out of life, such as the stomach takes what it wants out of the food to get the energy. So if we can't create a healthy environment, the stomach usually suffers, such as ulcers. When we're in an environment of stress all the time, and we can't control the environment to get what we want, and it's real stressful, the stomach will suffer. Anger in the liver is more of a reactive push against the world. The stomach is more of an absorption from the world. When we look at the different function of the liver, the stomach is hollow, so the stomach absorbs. It has a space inside of it to absorb from the food, from the environment energetically. The liver is spongy. It's already filled up. There is blood inside there, but there's spongy tissue. And so the liver is full. It's a full organ, so it exerts more of an external influence. It's more of a pushing out, such as anger. And then a stress, absorption of stress is the stomach. It's an internal thing. So the entire
That explains why sometimes when I'm eating, and if I think about those things, like if thoughts come, and before that I was in awareness, then all of a sudden, like, I could feel very subtly that I can't even swallow my food.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it almost, I don't know how to describe it, but...
Yeah, well, it's important to not eat when we're in heightened states of emotion like that. See, and what you're experiencing is that the energy from your interaction has imbalanced the energy of your stomach. So if you're, and also the other organs as well, if you're trying to eat food when the stomach is still imbalanced, it will create indigestion because the stomach is dealing with other energies and cannot perform the function of digestion properly. So what will happen as well is that the food will not be processed correctly, and therefore you won't get as much energy as your body can get from the food, which can result in stored toxins in the physical tissue of the body. That is why in Ayurveda it says very clearly to never eat a meal if you are in a state of stress. Never eat if you're angry, never eat if you're depressed. You should always try to restore balance to yourself first before you start to eat food. Now, for someone who's chronically in a state of emotional imbalance, they will need to eat in order to sustain their physical body, but they should be really working towards healing this chronic condition. And in many cases, doing fasts will help. And the reason being, it needs to be a fast that's physical as well as emotional. I have a video on this where I talked about fasting for spiritual purification. And so the fast is also limiting our environment so that our emotions have time to rest and to relax and to purify and to heal. So when we fast physically with food,